Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome this afternoon to a wonderful occasion that we have to have a civil rights icon, a poet who is just excellent, a legend with us this afternoon, Nikki Giovanni. And at this time, I'd like to introduce our president, Dr. Kendra Boggess.
Yes, my phone's ringing, I'm sorry. It's not supposed to happen up here. Thank you all for being here today. It's good to see everybody, and we are thrilled to have poet Nikki Giovanni. She was born in Knoxville, Tennessee, a little bit of information about her, on June 7th in a year, and I won't name. She can tell you that if she wants. Although she grew up in Cincinnati, Ohio, she and her sister returned to Knoxville each summer to visit their grandparents. Nikki graduated with honors in history from her grandfather's alma mater, Fisk University. Since 1987, she has been on the faculty at Virginia Tech, where she's a university distinguished professor. In her website biography, Dr. Giovanni stated, "I think I was lucky because I was always sniffling. Colds, allergies, something or another, which meant I got to stay home from school a lot, which meant I could read the books that I wanted to read. Mommy had a wonderful library, Richard Wright, Langston Hughes, Paul Lawrence, Dunbar John Hershey, but she also read trashy books that she kept in the back of her closet. I remember a nun once saying to me that Black Boy by Richard Wright was a bad book. I knew better. But I thanked her for letting me know just because you're grown and a nun, you don't necessarily know what's a good book from a bad book. I guess this is a way of saying I'm a dreamer," unquote. She goes on to describe her interest in and love of music and clarified, quote, "My dream was not to publish or to even be a writer. My dream was to discover something no one else had thought of. I guess that's why I'm a poet. We put things together in ways no one else does," unquote. Philpott sent me, or made a long list of awards and honors, and I'm gonna just say this, they are too numerous to mention. I'll mention a couple. She earned 7 NAACP Image Awards for a number of books, and I won't read them to you, but I know that if you looked her up, you could find them. She was named one of Oprah Winfrey's 25 living legends, and I think we do believe we have a living legend here. She's won the Governor's Award for the Arts in Virginia, and there's just page after page after page of wonderful accolades about the things that she's done. But I think better than reading them to you, I should let her come here and share her exciting and exquisite experience with you. Thank you, and welcome, Nikki.
Thank you very much. I want to start by thanking my sorors. I'm a member of Delta Sigma Theta, and it's really good to see my sorors have come with me today. One of the funny things, and I want to thank Concord for inviting me, and I know some of you are high school people, so you probably aren't interested, but one of the things that was excited me is I'm a TV freak, I guess you could call it. I look at Jeopardy every night. And Jeopardy started off, in all fairness to everybody, and I'm not in a bad mood or something, but Jeopardy started off with just having white writers. And so they only had white questions. And we know now that Jeopardy has hired some black people because they've been having some black questions. And I'm so happy about that. But one night, Jeopardy had Image Awards. So I'm sitting there eating dinner. Jeopardy comes on at 8 o'clock. I'm sitting, 7:30. And I'm sitting there, and it says, and it's a whole line, Image Awards. And so I'm sitting with my friend Jenny, and I said, oh, great, I'm gonna make Jeopardy. You know what I mean? I was excited, because I have 7. Nobody else has 7. And they went, dum-dum, dum-dum, dum-dum. I wasn't even a wrong answer. I was incredibly, incredibly sad. And then I went to class, and I said to my class, did you see what the hell happened? Oh, excuse me, did you see what? Did you see what happened on Jeopardy? They didn't even, you know, I wasn't even the wrong answer. And the class was like, and I'm like, don't you all, aren't you concerned about that? And finally, one of my students who feels pretty close to me, she said, you know, Nikki, we didn't want to see you make a fool of yourself. And I said, I have to tell you this. If the first time I ever make a fool of myself is on Jeopardy or Wheel of Fortune or some of that stuff, I would have led a blessed life. I'm not greedy. You know, you see those people. I hate those people on Wheel of Fortune. Don't you just hate them? And it'll be out there, you know, Saturday afternoon or something. And they'll have everything. And they'll do it one more time and they'll get bankrupt. And it's like, yes. You shouldn't be greedy. I just thought I would mention that to you. You know, you have to be very, very careful about that. But it's, I just thought I would mention that because, do you all remember, you all probably don't, you're too young. Do you remember Deal or No Deal? I'm going to read a poem. I wrote the poem, Deal or No Deal, for my students because I was upset with them. And I thought that I had a right to be upset, and I thought that they should be known for hurting my feelings. And so if you have a student, if you have a teacher who was supposed to be on one of those game shows, say something nice to them, damn it. Just reach out and say, oh, we wanted you to win, or, you know, something. You know, it doesn't matter what you really think, because a lot of times you'll find in life, when you get to be my age, a lot of times it doesn't ever matter what you really think. What you're trying to do is make people feel better. So I wrote a poem for English 4714, and just so they would definitely know who they are, CRN 16937. And I hope that their children and their grandchildren say, were you on, was that you, Grandpapa? And then you have to lie and say, no, I wasn't in that class. My class is not so sure that I should apply to Deal or No Deal. They think I am lucky, after all. I am teaching them. They know I'm smart. They are, for example, learning. Yet, they don't want to see me make those greedy mistakes and push beyond the envelope. The banker is neither friend nor foe. He's a machine. To think you can beat him is to think you will win at Vegas or love. But I persist. My dream is a red dress above my heel, above my knees, high-heeled red sandals, and me coming over the top, the music booming, doom 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 doom. Hi, Howie, I will say with a lovely smile. I don't want to play the game. I want to be it. They were born 40 years after me, yet I am younger. I know you cannot go through life unless you are willing, for love or money, to make a fool of yourself. Where else does the ecstasy lie? I love that. And of course, tomorrow is a great day. I guess most of you who are in high school, you're too young to vote, I think, but and that's too bad. But some of you who are in college, you're old enough to vote. So I know I'm in West Virginia and all of that, but I really hope that you don't make the mistake of voting for that fool Trump. I really don't. He's not only dumb, but he's mean, and he's trying to make, how can you be a white man and be afraid? That's what I don't understand. White men have been running the world for the last 500 or 600 years. There shouldn't be anything on earth that makes you scared. You should zip up your pants and say, I do not understand why people are running around, oh, I'm not so sure, you know, the Negroes are gonna come. Of course we're gonna come. You brought us here. How do you think? Of course. It's an incredible, incredible thing because we are America. And whatever America is, it's a great idea. And what we're trying to do is make it a better idea. And that's what you do. We keep bringing people in and keep bringing people in. If I had my way, which nobody listens to me, we would start in kindergarten with you all learning a second language. You would learn English, which some of you don't, no matter what you think you're speaking, it ain't English. And then you would learn something else. It doesn't matter if French, Spanish, Zulu, it doesn't matter, but you would learn something else so that as you grow up, you begin to know this is a world. And this is not what you all came to hear, but I just have to share this. I had the great fortune of having, I had great teachers, by the way. I had a great teacher named Louise Shoemaker. And Dr. Shoemaker was my professor, and I was getting an MFW, Master of Social Work, MSW. And Dr. Shoemaker, I loved her so much, really. And Dr. Shoemaker died. And her daughter called me. I was in London. And her daughter called me, and she said, you know, Mama is dying. She wasn't dead then. She said, Mama's dying, and I don't think that you, I don't think that you're gonna, she's gonna be alive when you get here. But I knew that whatever it is that love means, I needed to be back. She was in Philadelphia. I knew I needed to be back in Philadelphia. Now, I'm in London, and I needed to get back in Philadelphia right away. There's only one way to do it, and I'm lucky to be the age that I am. We had the old SST, the supersonic transport. Now, of course, I'm black, you can see that, and I'm poor because I'm a graduate student, so you probably can guess that. And so I had to figure out, now, how do I get credit card? And so I'm very pleasant. I'm not friendly, but I'm pleasant. And so I went and I filled out things, and I was telling the banker, you know, my parents will take care of and all this stuff. So he gave me, I don't know why he did, but I got a credit card. And what I wanted to do with the credit card was what I did, was I went and I bought a plane ticket, SST, to take me back and went back to New York. And they took you back and you were back in New York in 2 hours. It was great. And then I took a train down to Philly. Louise had died by then, but I was there. I went to the funeral. I did everything I was supposed to do, and I went back to London. I'm saying this to you because when you took the old SST, what you saw was the curve of the earth, because you were up at 70,000 feet and you could look and you could see that this is just a ball in space. And you all, everybody in this room that I can see right now, and I'm guessing, but I think I'm right, you all are too old to go into space. That's just not what you're going to be able to do. You're already too old. But your children will be able to go to Mars. Your children will be able to come home one day and say, Mom, I think I'm going to go up to Mars. I think that's what I want to do. And you'll say, well, you're not a physicist. You're not any kind of scientist. And the one thing that we need to do, I have the pleasure of being a friend of Dr. Bolden, who runs NASA. And I've been trying to teach Dr. Bolden, what we need to do is send writers into space. And we haven't sent any writers into space. We keep sending the scientists to space, and they keep saying this is what they've learned. But it's not what you've learned, it's what you've dreamed. We need to send an English major into space. We need to send her up, and we need to let her sit there for a while and see what is she dreaming of, what is she thinking about. Because we forget all the time, and I'm not against scientists and things. I think scientists are important, but we dream it up, and the scientists are the ones who make it happen. They don't dream it up, and we find the word for it. Am I making sense? And I think for those of you in this room, and some of you are English majors, and some of you are scientists, and some of you are looking at other things, but those of you who are daydreamers, those of you living in West Virginia, for example, I'm a Tennessean by birth. I'm an Appalachian. I grew up in Ohio. I'm still a part of Appalachia. We have to remember that the space program is an Appalachian dream. Because when you look at John Glenn, look at the astronauts. They're not from New York. They're not from Los Angeles. They're not from Chicago. They're all from our area. Because they were all sitting in the mountains and they were dreaming. And you and I have got to continue that dream of where do we go? Well, we go to Mars. We go up and we sit and we say, how do we get along? I know there's a rich guy, and I'm not against rich people, but I think that sometimes it's overblown. I mean, you have to have money. I mean, I'm not a fool. You have to have enough money to, you know, you want a car, you know, you want to go someplace. You know, I'm not crazy. You want caviar every now and then, a glass of champagne or something. But there's a limit to what you want. And there's a millionaire, a billionaire now, who says, I want to go up and colonize Mars. You probably have seen that. I want to colonize Mars. You say, well, you damn fool. Who's going to colonize? Why would we colonize Mars? Why wouldn't our thought be, we want to go and see if we can make friends? So for me, and I don't know if you saw The Martian. The only thing that's wrong with The Martian, I don't want you to think that I'm being prejudiced here, but the only thing that's wrong with that movie is that they had a white man to go up to Mars. What we needed to go up to Mars was a black woman, because black women get along with everybody. We do. We would go up to Mars, we'd land, we'd look around. Hey, baby, anybody here? That's what black women do. We'd find a way to cook whatever it is that's up there that's edible. Whatever it is, we would end up birthing, because we mate with every damn thing. You can see that, look at the history. You know that's true. We would mate with it, we would birth it, and we would love it. And that's the way we have to look at space. And you all, as I say, you're too old to go into space. But one of the things you can do is prepare your children to go up and sit there and decide, how do we deal with this? How do we function with this? How do we make this happen? And you have to have dreams. And so that's what I'm saying to you. I'm an old woman, so I'll be gone when most of you are doing whatever it is that you do. I'm 73 years old. With any luck, I might live another 10 years, doubtful. And it'll be sad. I mean, I'll be sorry to leave because there are things that I want to see. But then I'm not sure what it means, because I'm not sure what it means to be born. I'm not sure what I don't remember when I was in my mother. And I wish that there was a way that there was, I could drink something or eat something and figure that out. But some of you are writers, and some of you are dreamers, and some of you might have something in your head that the only way you could remember it is that you were in your mother. We are in an area where it's quiet and it's dark. And there's something that's being told to us in Appalachia that we have to listen to. In all fairness to everybody, the greatest white people in America are Appalachians. These are the people, we are the people from Alabama up to Maine. We are the people that have stood for America. If you were a slave running away, if you could get to any part of Appalachia, the white people in Appalachia weren't sending you back. We are here, I'm here right now in Athens. If you could get to Athens, the white people in Athens were very clear. We will not send our sons to die so that the Shenandoah can have slaves. And the one thing that we resent, the one thing that I so regret about Appalachia right now is that we have allowed fools to take our great history away from us. We have allowed them to take it and to steal from us the fact that we are the greatest Americans ever, because we are the people who stood for what America stood for. And it's incredibly important that we take our history back. It's incredibly important that we be proud of who we are. We are not Snuffy Smith and Louisa. We are not, you know, overweight women and little men with a cigar in their mouth. We are a great people. And those of us who are history majors are going to have to go back and look at it. We cannot let people laugh at us. We cannot let people put us down. We are the people who are doing the future. And it's very important. I'm so glad to be here with Concord today. We are the people who are making the future. And you can't let anybody take that away from you. Who you are is incredibly important to what this nation will be. Those of us who are 18, I hope you're voting tomorrow. I hope, of course, I have my pen on. I hope we're voting for Hillary because I'm a Hillary fan. But even if you're not, which I would regret, but even if you're not, you have to have a voice. You can't let people tell you, oh, it doesn't matter. You have to vote because it is not a privilege. It is a duty. It is a responsibility. And you have to get, if you're sick, I have a friend who's sick right now, and we told her, you know, if you're dead, we're going to carry you to the polls tomorrow. And we'll stand you up and we'll put you down. You have to vote. It's important that you be a part of the citizenry of this nation. It's important that you do that. I hope that you've all been registered to vote, and I hope that you all remember that as citizens, that's important. That's what you do. You are responsible for who we will become. And somebody said, well, Nikki, what if we lose? We never lose. We just didn't get what we thought we should get. Did I make sense on that? But that's like falling in love, in all fairness. And some of you have been in love. Some of you are not old enough to be in love. You're mostly in sex. But you know that's true. You know that's true. But it's like being in love. You never make a mistake in love. You just know that's not the right person for you. So you leave that person and go find somebody else. That's what you do. And I think that only makes sense. You all are young, so you're going to be in sex with a lot of the time. You have to be responsible with that. I just thought I'd mention that. You do. You have to be responsible, of course. But nonetheless, you have to recognize, oh, this ain't working. And I don't know what we do with men. I don't know what we're doing to men, because I think it's so awful that we have made the penis some kind of weapon. We have. Men run around, oh, my penis is erected, I have to go get something. No, you don't. Take a shower. Do something that makes sense. Anything else make you crazy and make you mad and makes everybody else mad at you, and that's not what you want to do. That's why you go to college, because you're here at college, and then you learn to say please. Please, And somebody will say yes, because women say yes to everything. You've seen that. Don't trap yourself in your penis. Somehow or another, that's true. Somehow or another, we want men to be cockhounds, and we want women to be virgins. And that's insane. That's insane. What we need to do is find a way to let us all find a way to be better. Now, that was my... I'll do something that makes more sense. I just thought I'd mention that. I was asked, and I'm pleased to do it. I am 73, which puts me, I was born in 1943, which is a good age. You all are the other side of segregation. I was born in segregation. I grew up with signs, you know, colored only, white only. I grew up with all of that. And of course, my generation is the generation that fought against it because it needed to go down because it's making everybody crazy. One of the great people of my generation, of course, was Rosa Parks. And I have the pleasure actually of knowing people on both sides. I know the kids. Speaking of which, can I just say this? Is little Wayne insane? Don't we need to put him in a hospital or something? He needs therapy or something. I mean, and I hope that you all don't buy anything that he has. Son of a bitch is crazy to be talking to people like that. That's the truth, excuse me. That's the truth. But we had good men, Tupac, and I've got a thug life. We had good men, and I think it's important. I had the pleasure of meeting Rosa Parks, and someone asked me, would you share how you met Rosa Parks? And I've traveled most of my life. It's only recently, my first real job, finish your sentence, Nikki, my first real job was Virginia Tech. And I never had a real job before that. And so getting a job at Tech, well, Tech is like a family, so it's not a job to me, it's home. And when I got to Tech, it was like, oh, I'm home. I knew I was home. I brought my mother down, I brought my sister down, but it was just, I knew that this was where I was going to be, and I was very happy. But I met Ms. Parks because I was going someplace in Pennsylvania. I really don't know where. But Philadelphia used to have a really crappy airport before they built the real one. It was like a piece of crap, and there's no other word for it. And it was raining one day. And so you know when it's raining, I guess it'd be like, well, I know it's like being in Roanoke, which is just as bad. I don't know where you guys fly out of. And you know on the rainy days, you're not going anyplace, you know, so you know that. But you also know that you don't know when it's going to stop. So you have to get up, which I did, and go to the airport. So if you were trying to get to, you know, UPenn or something, whenever they went, you would be able to go. So I walked in, and I'm looking because I'm a nervous individual, which you don't know, but I will share that. And it's because I'm a 60s person. I've grown up in that. So I'm always looking for where is my back. I always know where my back is, and it's still a habit. I'm not, you know, scared here, but when I came in, I checked the room. It's just what I do because I grew up with people who did ugly things to people, so you want to know where your back is. And so I checked my back, and my back is going to be over here. And so I walked over, and I'm going to sit down, and I am very, very fortunate, and some of you may share that with me. I can sleep anywhere. I could actually stand here, and if we weren't doing anything, I would get a good little nap in. So I'm sitting there, and I was just getting ready to go to sleep when I looked over there. And I said, my goodness, that woman looks like Rosa Parks. And Ms. Parks is a pretty woman, and, you know, she always held herself. And you know how you just like, that looks like Rosa Parks. So I can't half see, I'm blind anyway. I put my glasses on and I said, my God, it's Rosa Parks, because it was. And she travels with someone, and so that person was on her right. And I know the white guys here are gonna think, you know, Nikki's picking on us, but I'm not. But there was a white guy on her left. And so I'm looking and I said, no, I wanna meet Mrs. Parks. So how shall we do that? And so I'm looking, I'm thinking, okay, I'm intelligent enough to know I cannot move that black woman. I would be a fool to think so. So the only person that can move is going to be the white guy. And so my question is, how do I get him to move? And so I was thinking, now I could walk over and I could say, excuse me, sir, you're sitting next to a cultural icon and I'd like to have your seat, please. But then he would know what he's got. and being what he is, he wouldn't give it up. You see what I'm saying? Or I could do that thing that we call bogarting. I don't know if the white people in this room know what bogarting is. I know the black people do. And you kind of... And so I just walked in front of him, and he looked up, and I said, are you going to move or what? And he said, oh, I'm sorry, and he moved, which is what he was supposed to do. And I sat down and said, Ms. Parks, you know, I'm the, you know, yakety yak, and we met. And it was really wonderful because we began a friendship. And it was so, so lovely. I have some deltas here. I don't know if I have any AKAs here. But as our friendship developed, you know, Ms. Parks had to leave, as you know, had to leave Montgomery. And she ended up in Detroit and stuff. And we would go. Ms. Parks was a tea drinker. I'm a coffee drinker. And so we would sit there. And I can share this to you, if you're ever dealing with famous people like that, there's no point in talking about what they've done, because they know what they've done. And there's no point in talking about how much you appreciate it, because they know how much you appreciate it. You know, it's just gonna go on. So we used to, you know, chit-chat about other things. And I said to her one day, you know, Ms. Parks, I said, it's amazing. When I think about your life, to realize that you only made one mistake. And Ms. Parks is very, she's very, very contained. But you could see her face dropped. It just caught her off guard a little bit. And she said, and what would that be, baby? I said, you went AKA. You know, she should have been a Delta. But some of you don't know what that, but that, and we started laughing. But I wrote a poem I'd like to share. When Mrs. Parks passed, I was invited to do a poem. And in doing a poem for Mrs. Parks, you could, for those of you who write, you could write what Rosa Parks did, or you could do the history of it. But I thought, in order to actually get it done, what I needed to do was start with where it started. Am I making, that's a bad sentence. But I knew that what I wanted to start with, of course, was the Pullman Porters, and probably the greatest group of men in America like that were the Pullman Porters. They carried everything. They carried, the train ran, as you know, from Chicago all the way down through, it came through Atlanta, and then it goes over through Mississippi, goes down to New Orleans, and then it comes back. So the Pullman Porters were, and any of you who are history majors, it's a wonderful thing to look up. The Pullman Porters were, first of all, the bankers of the civil rights movement. Every time Thurgood Marshall needed money, he got on a train, and the Pullman Porters took the money that they had been collected. Every time Nat King Cole was on there, and any of the jazz people, they would say, you know, give this to NAACP or give this to Mr. Marshall. And so they kept the money. There was never, and it's an amazing, wonderful thing, there was never any question that any of the money did not get there. But they also brought the papers down. The Amsterdam News, they brought the Chicago Tribune, so that people in the South would know that they were not alone. And of course, as we're going to deal with here, they also brought Emmett Till on their train. And we know that Emmett's going to have to get off the train in Mississippi, and we know that that's going to lead to a whole another thing. So when I was invited, and I was very glad to do so, to write a poem for Rosa, and I'd like to share that with you. This is for the Pullman Porters, who organized when people said they couldn't, and carried the Pittsburgh Courier and the Chicago Defender to the black Americans in the South so that they would know they were not alone. This is for the Pullman Porters, who helped Thurgood Marshall go South and come back North to fight the fight that resulted in Brown versus the Board of Education. Because even though Kansas is West, and even though Topeka is the birthplace of Gwendolyn Brooks, who wrote the powerful The Chicago Defender Sends a Man to Little Rock, it was the Pullman Porters who whispered to the traveling men, both the blues men and the race men, so that they both would know what was going on. This is for the Pullman Porters who smiled as if they were happy and laughed like they were tickled when some folks were around, and who silently rejoiced in 1954 when the Supreme Court announced its 9-0 decision that separate is inherently unequal. This is for the Pullman Porters who smiled and welcomed a 14-year-old boy onto their train in 1955. They noticed his slight limp that he tried to disguise with a doo-wop walk. They noticed his stutter and probably understood why his mother wanted him out of Chicago during the summer when school was out. 14-year-old black boys with limps and stutters are apt to try to prove themselves in dangerous ways when mothers aren't around to look after them. So this is for the Pullman porters who looked over that 14-year-old while the train rolled the reverse of the Blues Highway from Chicago to St. Louis to Memphis to Mississippi. This is for the men who kept him safe. And if Emmett Till had been able to stay on the train all summer, he would have maybe grown a bit of a paunch, certainly lost his hair, probably have worn bifocals and bounced his grandchildren on his knee, telling them about his summer riding the rails. But he had to get off that train and ended up in Money, Mississippi, and was horribly, brutally, inexcusably, and unacceptably murdered. This is for the Pullman porters who, when the sheriff was trying to get that body secretly buried, got Emmett's body on the northbound train, got his body home to Chicago, where his mother said, "I want the world to see what they did to my boy." And this is for all the mothers who cried. And this is for all the people who said, "Never again." And this is about Rosa Parks, whose feet were not so tired. It had been, after all, an ordinary day until the bus driver gave her the opportunity to make history. This is about Mrs. Rosa Parks from Tuskegee, Alabama, who was also the field secretary of the NAACP. This is about the moment Rosa Parks shouldered her cross, put her worldly goods aside, was willing to sacrifice her life so that that young man in Money, Mississippi, who had been so well protected by the Pullman porters, would not have died in vain. When Mrs. Parks said no, a passionate movement was begun. No longer would there be a reliance on the law, there would be a higher law. When Mrs. Parks brought that light of hers to expose the evil of the system, the sun came and rested on her shoulders, bringing the heat and light of truth. Others would follow Mrs. Parks. Four young men in Greensboro, North Carolina, would also say no. Great voices would be raised, singing the praises of God and exhorting us to forgive those who trespassed against us. But it was the Pullman porters who forgave, but it was the Pullman porters who safely got Emmett to his grand uncle. And it was Mrs. Rosa Parks who could not stand that death. And in not being able to stand it, she sat back down. Thank you. I started off writing normal length poetry, and then it just kept getting longer and longer and longer. And then I just thought, well, I don't care if nobody wants to read, it's okay. Well, you have to think like that, otherwise you're. For those of us who want to be writers, you have a story to tell. I say this to my students all the time too. And one of the things, I have two students who are good writers. That's the truth. Julia is a good writer, she's going on. And Matt is a good writer, but Matt worries that nobody will like what he's writing. There has to be another better way of saying it, but that's what Matt worries about, that how will they like what I'm writing? And, you know, to hell with that. What you want to do is to write your story, because most of the good stories that are written, for example, just for quickie, Anne Frank kept a diary, and she kept it for all of that time. And the Nazis came and got her, and she was killed. Her father, as you know, was able to escape, and he kept the diary. Anne was gone, and he showed it to some people, and finally, we all got to see Anne Frank's diary. Anne didn't know when she was writing that it would matter to the world. She had no way of knowing that. And I'm not saying that you're gonna die. I'm not gonna say that, you know, somebody's gonna come and get you. I'm saying that what you write, think about it. Jane Austen had no idea that what she was going to write was going to be read all of this time. I'm reading right now Wind in the Willow, 200 damn years old. Who would have thought when you wrote that, 200 years from now, somebody would be reading it? You don't know. And so the main thing you can do is tell the truth as you know it. And I'm going to say again, because this is such an important part of America, and this is such an important part of what we are and what we can become. What you have to say, those of you who write, whether it's poetry, whether it's songs, whatever it is, those of you who write, you have something to say, and what you have to do is say it. And don't worry about it. You're college graduates. Not one of you in this room, and some of you are high schoolers, not one of you in this room is going to be hungry. Not one of you in this room is going to be starving. And that's the truth. Not one of you in this room is actually going to be cold. People make you think that, but it's not true. You're Americans, and we're going to take care of you one way or the other. One way is by, of course, having some people pay their taxes. I pay my taxes. I think Donald Trump ought to pay his. I do. That's a whole other thing. But I'm a mountaineer, and I wanted to share this because I was born in Knoxville. I was the first person in my family, by the way, who was born in a hospital. So I'm the baby in the family. And any of you, the baby in your family, you know what kind of crap I had to go through. Because anytime my sister got mad at me, and I know some people in this room know my sister, but anytime she got angry with me, she would say, oh, we made a mistake. When we went to the hospital to pick you up, we got the wrong baby. And it took me the longest before I realized, the hell with you. It took that long. Because, you know, you grew up thinking, oh, that's not really my mother. And then you thought, well, whether she is or not, I'm all she's got and she's all, you know. I'm not going to deal with that because it'll make you crazy. People make you crazy like that. But I wrote When God Made Mountains because I'm a mountaineer. When God made mountains, he made runaway slaves with no book knowledge of the North Star nor botany classes describing moss on the north side of trees. He made black men and women unafraid of mountain lions and Florida panthers. And no matter what Teddy Roosevelt tried to show, bears do not like people. Not the cuddly little koala, not the fierce grizzly, not the mighty polar, nor the humble mountain black bear. All bears and their dens are to be avoided. God did make the jackrabbit who could be snared. God made the possum who is slow. God made the clever raccoon and rivers sweet with fish. He made berries and nuts and green leafy things which were safe and good to eat. When God made runaway slaves, he knew they would need a friend, not only in nature, but of a humankind. So he sent mountaineers. He sent white people who would not be a slave nor own one, who would not kill a slave owner nor die for one. He sent a free white man who believed in change and a free white woman who believed in him, and they made their homes amid these mighty mountains. They liked to have a drink or two, so they welcomed Johnny Appleseed, who brought stories and fermented Applejack. They liked heroes, so they welcomed the traveling preacher with his message of a man who has trampled out the vineyard where the grapes of wrath are stored. They liked to sing, so they welcomed the runaway slave with his banjo, and friendships were formed. When God made mountains, he made men and women who would need each other, who would respect each other, who would carry the word so that all men and women could be saved. When God made mountains, he said, "Come unto me, ye who need rest." And they called it Appalachia, the original word for peace. And some people said, "This cannot be done." And the rest said, "Yes, we can." And the clouds settled in that welcome place between the ground and trees and sky. Like smoke coming off a coffee pot, like steam coming from a kettle of pinto beans, like the rustic smell of a wood-burning fire at day's end, at home and at peace, like God has a rocking chair in his sky, smoking his pipe and being proud of his great smoky mountains. I like that. Thank you. I'm prejudiced to that. I think that, again, one of the things that you definitely want to do is deal with what you want to deal with. And I think that that's an incredibly part of what it is that you say. Your voice is important. No matter what anybody else says, your voice is important. I wonder if you all are too young for me to read this. I fall in love all the time, and it's a nice thing to do. It's fun. I'm old enough. You all aren't, but I am. And one of the advantages of falling in love, of course, is that you get poetry. Now, you know, the songwriters get these lovely, you know, songs, but we in the poems, we just get our poems. We don't get a whole lot more, but I fell in love. And it was fun to do, and I was thinking, what would I like for him to do for me? And of course, the one thing that I definitely wanted him to do is cook. Now, men have learned to cook. When I was growing up, men didn't cook. It just didn't happen. All the cooking was done by women. But now, and we have to thank FDR. I hope some of you are history majors with that. We have to thank FDR, because when FDR appointed, I can't think of her name right now, as right. And she decided that cooking was not domestic, but it was a profession. And so then all of a sudden the men decided they could cook. So now when you look at who are the great cooks in America, who do you see? A whole bunch of guys. And nothing wrong with that, because if you marry one of them, you got to make them work. Yeah, why not? They're not doing anything else, sitting around talking. So let them go to work. So I wrote a poem, and I like it a lot. It's called Still Life with Apron. I would like to see you cooking. I would like for you to cook for me. I would like to see you decide upon a menu, go to the market and pick the fruit, the vegetable, the fish. I would like to see you smell the fish, test the flesh for freshness and firmness. I would like to watch you in the bakery by the dinner rolls, deciding rolls or crusty bread. I would watch you run back to get the goat butter. I would like to be sitting in a corner and you, intent upon your meal, not noticing me when you go to the wine store. I would watch you wrestle with red or white. White, of course, because it's fish, but red is seductive. Who ever fell in love over a glass of white wine? I, uncharacteristically on time, would like you to greet me in a butcher's apron. I would like to watch you greet me only in an apron. You would ask me to undress for you. Before I sit down at the beautiful table, before you hand me my glass, you would ask me to undress. I would like to watch you watch me undressing for you. I would like to watch the movement inside the apron as I undress for you. I would like to watch you stroll to your closet, where you bring out your old buffalo plaid dressing gown, your pilly, much-washed dressing gown that smells like you after you brush your teeth, after you shower, after you comb your hair. I would like to embrace your odor, your essence, as we sit down to eat. I would like for you to cook for me. I would like that very much. Somebody, I won't get invited back. A long time ago, and somebody mentioned it, one of my sorors mentioned me, a long time ago, I did an album called Truth Is On Its Way. And I was just fortunate. I keep saying I'm not friendly, but I met the guy who headed Lincoln Center. And what I've always loved is spirituals. I grew up with the spiritual. My grandmother was a Mount Zion Baptist Church. When the family moved to Cincinnati, my mother joined an AME church because that was what was close. And so that's African Methodist Episcopal. I got somebody the other day on that because they didn't know. Probably some of you all don't either. And the question was a CME. And of course, that's the colored Methodist Episcopal Church. But I know y'all don't know it, so I just thought I'd tell you that. And if you find yourself, then you know. But one of the things that I grew up with was the spirituals, which are just absolutely beautiful. And I wanted to find a way to put the spirituals with poetry, with my poetry. And so we did. And then I wanted to sell it. Now, the problem with Lincoln Center is that it's like about 1,500 seats. And so it's one of those things, like people tell you things, and I'm saying this to you because there's gonna be something that you'll wanna do, and you'll say, oh, I can't do it. You can't do it, why not? And so we had 1,500 seats to sell. I could get Lincoln Center for free if I could fill 1,500 seats. If I didn't fill 1,500 seats, I was gonna owe a lot of money, which I didn't have. And so what I just did is I just kept going out and begging people to buy tickets, and we finally were able to do that. I'm saying this because I really think I should sue Hamilton. Because I know that he got that idea from me. And you know how you just sit there and you're saying, damn, I should sue him. He's making a lot of money off of an idea that I had 30 years ago. But that would be something else entirely, I guess. But I just thought I'd mention that. You got to go ahead and do whatever it is that you think you should do, because why not? And somebody will say you can't do it, but of course you can. And if you can't do it, you'll learn that you can't do it, which is not a failure, but something that you've learned. But I wrote a poem that I wanted to share. I wanted to close on because we're going to do some Q&A. I think that there might be some questions that you have for somebody like me. And a long, long, long time ago, I wrote a poem called Ego Tripping. And it's one of those poems that, you know how you write a poem and you don't you don't know what it's going to be. We're talking about what does and doesn't happen. And so I wrote it, and I read it. First time I read it was in Boston. And I had no idea that people would actually like it. It's just, you just read the poem and everybody's like, oh. But the New York Times, which was just lucky, New York Times, somebody heard it and ended up putting it in the New York Times. So I got that section of the New York Times. So now you're going to have essentially a career. A lot of people got upset, by the way, because people get upset. And you all are all old enough to know that there are things that you do that people are jealous. And people will say, you know, and they'll try to make you feel bad about it. You must get rid of those people. Immediately, you know, just get rid of them, because they're not going to do you any good, and trying to make them like you will not do you any good. Get rid of them and find some people who are proud of you. And I'm good at getting rid of people. You got to be good at something. I'm really good at that, and I'm a good cook. So I wrote a poem, and I'm going to close on that. This is called Ego Tripping. There may be a reason why. I was born in the Congo. I crossed the Fertile, excuse me, I walked to the Fertile Crescent and built the Sphinx. I designed a pyramid so tough that a star that only glows every 100 years falls into the center, giving divine, perfect light. I'm bad. I sat on the throne drinking nectar with Allah. I got hot and sent an ice age to Europe to cool my thirst. My oldest daughter is Nefertiti. The tears from my birth pains created the Nile. I am a beautiful woman. I gazed on the forest and burned out the Sahara Desert. With a packet of goat's meat and a change of clothes, I crossed it in 2 hours. I'm a gazelle. So swift, you can't catch me. For a birthday present when he was 3, I gave my son, Hannibal, an elephant. He gave me Rome for Mother's Day. My strength flows ever on. My son, Noah, built Newark, and I stood proudly at the helm as we sailed on a soft summer day. I turned myself into myself and was Jesus. Men intoned my loving name. All praises, all praises. I am the one who would save. I sowed diamonds in my backyard. My bowels deliver uranium. The filings from my fingernails are semi-precious jewels. On a trip north, I caught a cold and blew my nose, giving oil to the Arab world. I am so hip, even my errors are correct. I sailed west to reach east and had to round off the earth as I went. The hair from my head thinned, and gold was laid across 3 continents. I am so perfect, so divine, so ethereal, so surreal, I cannot be comprehended except by my permission. I mean, I can fly like a bird in the sky.
Thank you so much, Dr. Giovanni, for that wellspring and wealth of wisdom, words, and your works that you shared with us. All these W's came flowing into my head as I listened to you speak. But thank you so much. At this time, I'd like to ask the members of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority to come forward, please. Sir Giovanni, I would like to introduce Marsha Lawson, who's our West Virginia State Coordinator, to make her special presentation for you. Okay.
Good evening, Sir Giovanni. I am Marsha Lawson, the West Virginia State Coordinator, under the direction of Dr. Monin Davenport, the Midwest Regional Director. When we heard that you were coming, we were really excited. And so on behalf of the members of Bluefield Alumni Chapter, which Carolyn Williams is the president, we want to give you this little special gift. And I have this right here because I had talked to one of my sorors that you had spoke with in the Eastern Panhandle, and she told me that you like pound cakes. So on my birthday, I made you a cake.
Happy birthday. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to open us up for questions and answers for Dr. Giovanni. If you have any, just raise your hands. And you, Ms. Philpott has a microphone here for you to come forward and you can ask your question.
Okay, don't everybody speak at once.
Yes, my name is Tiffany Quest, Tiffany Jones, and I'm a teacher at Bluefield High School. And it's going to be hard to beat meeting Rosa Parks, but is there anyone else of historical importance that you've met over the course of your 73 years?
Again, it's one of those, because of where I was born and where we were, I actually knew a lot of people. And a good friend was, and I hope that you do know her too, was Margaret Walker, who wrote, of course, Jubilee, and who wrote the really beautiful For My People. And Margaret was a good cook. Margaret lived in Jackson, Mississippi, and Margaret lived, if this was Margaret's house, this was Medgar Evers. And of course, Medgar was murdered. I mean, she heard the shots. But Margaret was a good cook, and so I used to go down, and we would cook together. And I have to tell you this, and in all fairness to everybody, and of course we love you know, Maya, but Maya was not. She always thought of herself as a good cook, but she really wasn't. she wasn't. Miss Stuckey was a good cook, and so but Maya was down in Wake Forest. So she was only a couple of hours. She was as close to me as you all are. And we used to go down. And most of the people, you know, you met pretty much everybody. I'm trying to think of who I didn't meet. You know, people got killed. The one person that I wanted to be closer to, and I just met her only briefly, was Fannie Lou Hamer. And it's the thing, because I know you all are young, and I just didn't want to stand here and just, you know, boom, boom, boom at you all. But, you know, it was Ms. Hamer who in 64 created the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. And she took a bus over to Atlantic City. And Lyndon Johnson was going to be the president because, you know, Jack was murdered. Kennedy was murdered. And Lyndon was going to be the president. But she had the group that was a mixed group, white and black, everything. And of course, the traditional Mississippi Democratic Party was trying to block her off, and Ms. Hamer was like, no, you know, we represent that. And so Lyndon offered her two seats as a part of the Democratic Party. And Ms. Hamer said, we didn't come here, if I may quote Ms. Hamer, we didn't come here for no two seats. And they left. The reason that all of us, 18-year-olds, the reason that we can vote is Ms. Hamer. And they drove back to Mississippi, and it always makes me cry, so I hope I don't cry. But when they crossed the border into Mississippi, the state troopers pulled her over, pulled her out. And one of the most incredible beatings that any human being had to take, she was beaten and just incredibly bad. And one of the reasons that people like me, and that's why I was saying to you all, no matter what, I know who I'm in favor of, but that's not the point. The point is, no matter who, you have to vote. You have to vote, because people took incredible beatings just so that you would have the right to vote. Whether you roll it up, but it doesn't matter, you have to vote. You can't say, oh, it doesn't matter, nobody's paying attention. Nobody pays attention to any of us. You think anybody's paying attention to Dan Poet? Nobody pays attention to any of us. But I still think I have a duty to say what I believe. And I wanted to know, Mrs. Hamer, we took a ham down to her once, you know, and I just didn't get to know Mrs. Hamer because for all of the beatings that she took, you know, she died, she and Pappy both, and they died very much close to each other. And so that was a great loss. But you know, I'm kin to Lena Horne. So there's just a lot of people that you knew and you know, you ate with or you drank with or you know, hung out with. And then some people you didn't, and some people you didn't. I'm really sorry for our soror, you know, Cosby, Mrs. Cosby, because Bill is crazy and needs to be put, no, that's sick. because no matter how you look at it, you all are probably maybe too young to know, but it's just sex. And you just can't be going around giving people drugs and trying to, I don't know what's going on. But Bill is crazy, and it's going to, things like that. And there's no way that we as a sorority can help her. I mean, there's nothing we can do about it, so you're sorry about that. But you know these people, and then other people you meet. But it's always a pleasure to, know, of course, Jean Noble, we knew, and a lot of people, I mean, again, my sorority is here, but it was Jean Noble who, when the Little Rock Nine, when that happened, it was Jean Noble, and she used to wear that white suit, remember she used to wear that white suit, and Jean got on the train and said, we're going to Little Rock, and the Deltas went to Little Rock, and that's one of the things that helped us. And I remember getting a call from Sora Nova, and she was down, this was much later, she was in Texas, and she said, you have to come down because we have to elect Barbara Jordan. And who's Barbara Jordan? But it didn't matter who Barbara Jordan was. It was that Jean called, and we had to go. And so we went. But the Deltas, by the way, own a satellite, as we all know. We haven't done anything with it, but our soror, Lillian Bimbo, bought a satellite, and everybody laughed and said, why does Lillian buy the satellite? Because it's there, damn it. What do you mean, what you buy? And it's important. We haven't done anything with it, but the Deltas own it. And at some point, that satellite might be significant. And I'm trying to think of who I should be able to say that you might be able to say, oh, my goodness. But you meet everybody because you just, I'm just a kid, and I'm one of those people that, I didn't start drinking until I came to tech, by the way. So that's the truth. So I was always sober, I was always aware, and I almost called my new book Surveillance, because I always watched. It's the one thing that I did, and it wasn't until, as I say, until I got to tech that I actually took a drink. Do I have a moment of your time? My mother, my new book is called A Good Cry, and it's called A Good Cry because women don't cry. Men write books about us that we're always crying, but if you talk to your girlfriends, we weren't, because your girlfriends say don't cry, and your girlfriends help you, and we do what has to do. My mother died on June 24th, and my sister died on August the 10th. My Aunt Ann died on the 29th of October, and my dog Wendy died on the 10th of December, so this was a lot. And right now, I'm the second oldest person in the family, and my aunt, who is 93, I'm 73, and Ag is in the hospital, so I'm going to soon be, most likely, the oldest person in the family, so you have things to do, and you can't sit down and cry. You see what I'm saying? And Mommy was a beer drinker. Somebody here knows Mommy. Mommy was a beer drinker, and every day, Mommy had a beer, and so we knew Mommy was dying the day that she said she didn't want a beer. 2 days later, she was dead. And so you have to bury her, you have to, sell the house, or I'm renting it actually, you have to sell the car. I mean, just don't, you have things to do. And so you do them. And then finally, I could sit down, and it's been almost 10 years, that I could finally sit down and mourn the loss of my mother, whom I miss a lot. I dream about her a lot. And I was laughing because I have a dog, and I said to the dog, we ought to drink a beer for grandmother. I hope that you talk to your dog. I do. I said, we ought to drink a beer to grandmother. But I, frankly speaking, don't like beer. I never did see how people drank it. It just, why would you do that? And so I decided if I'm going to do it, I'm going to do the best beer in the world. I said, what's the number one beer? So I decided to take the dog. The dog's name was Wendy. And I said to Wendy, let's go up to BNN and see what the number one beer is. I don't know if you looked at the books, but the beer books and things like that, they're $30 and they're big. And I didn't care about beer. I just wanted to know what was number one. And so I walk in with my dog, and I didn't realize dogs were not welcome in BNN. And so the manager came over and said, Nikki, the dog isn't welcome. And I'm like, oh, I just want to know what the beer is. So sometimes you just can't pay any attention to the rules. So I went on over, because you can't, if you do that, next thing you have to buy the book or something. So I just went on over, opened up the book. I said, we'll be out in a minute. I'm holding the dog, and looked up. The number one beer in the world is Utopia. And Utopia is $350 a pint. It's serious beer, and it's serious business. And It's only every other year, for those of you who drink beer. This is 16. There was no utopia in 16. There'll be a utopia in 17, and there was a utopia in 15. And I thought, okay, and I called Keith, who's a wine, he does the thing. I called Keith and said, you know, hey, it's Nikki, you know, would you hold a utopia for me? I come over and get it. Even though it was expensive, after all, it's your mother, you only have one. And he said, we don't sell beer. And you know how you talk to, we don't, you know how people talk and you, we're not paying attention to each other. I think it's men, the way, frankly speaking, the men talk to women. And so they talk louder and slower. We don't sell utopia. And because I thought he didn't understand me, I thought I should talk louder and slower. I only want one. And so we went back and forth until I finally realized he doesn't have utopia. And there's a place in California, it's called Bounty Hunter, and Bounty Hunter has everything. So I called Bounty Hunter, I said, I'd like a utopia, you know, Giovanni in Virginia, I'd like a utopia, can you send it out? And he said, that's a beer. And you know, I could just hear the, ugh. And I thought, we're not gonna get any beer from that. And so now I'm on a quest, I'm chasing utopia. And I'm going around, and nobody has utopia, you know. And so it's getting to be February, and now I'm doing something, if you'll excuse me, called bitching. And so I'm on, you know, radio, and I'm on television and stuff, and I'm saying, I'm trying to find a utopia. I can't find a utopia. And I'm going around and around and around. I guess everybody got tired of hearing me. I found out I'm speaking at the CIA, and they needed me. I'm at the CIA, and I asked, Leon Panetta was there, and I asked Leon, I said, Leon, can you do me a favor? I know it's illegal, but we all do favors. I said, can you do me a favor? And he said, oh, no, certainly. You know how they do it, certainly. I said, I'm looking for a utopia. And he said, look deep inside. So I know this is not working. And so I knew that Leon was gonna go on and do something else because he didn't have time to, they had a lunch, but he was busy. And so I asked his assistant, and I said, you know, I'm just trying to find a utopia. And he's doing the same thing, and I'm sure you will. So, and I laugh about it, but it's true. There's just sometimes you need a black man. And I thought, well, I'm just gonna find a black man because he's gonna at least understand what I'm saying. I did. And I said to him, I'm trying to get a utopia. He said, oh, I have to find a safe computer. And so we went in, and you're not allowed. Like, I had to turn away from it, but he found it. He said, it's in Canada. I can find you one in Canada. And somehow, I just didn't want to buy an American beer in Canada. It just, something set me wrong with that. And so I continued forward bitching. And finally, I was on NPR in Newark, and the phone rang on the radio, and somebody, whoever it was, said, it's a Sam Adams beer. And would you tell Dr. Giovanni that we are sending her a utopia and the glasses to drink it out of? So that was really nice. Now, the good part about utopia was, my good friend, and I hope you've read his book, it's called Booked is One, and he just won the Newbery Prize for, my mind is gone right now, and so he is saying to me, and I was trying to figure out who to drink it with, because now you got it. And he's a good friend to Queen Juanita, who is the queen of Kano in Ghana. And so Queen Juanita said to me, you know, why don't you bring utopia and we'll drink it here? And I said, you know, whatever you think, and I always try to be polite about that, ma'am, whatever you think, they're never, TSA is not gonna let me bring beer out of the United States. If we're gonna drink it together, you have to come to the United States. She said, I'm not planning to come to the United States. I said, okay. But we have an expression in the black community that says, God is good all the time, right? And so her best friend got sick, and her best friend lives in Barbados. And so she flew over to Barbados. And once you fly to Barbados, you're only 3 hours away. So she called Kwame, because they're a good friend, and said, you know, if I come up, will you take me over to Nikki's? And he was like, you know, yeah, sure, he called me. And I keep a good house, and I'm a good, but when he said, you know, Queen Juanita is coming, I had to clean, I had to dust, I was polishing, you know, you don't get a queen in your house very often. I was like, oh my. And I fixed a really, really good dinner, and they came, and we had dinner. And then after dinner, we opened the utopia. Now, Queen Juanita had enough sense, because like that, that's what the glass, she had enough sense to drink her glass. We all, you know, my friend Jenny was there, and she drank her glass. Kwame and I sat there, because now we got the rest of the beer, and we continued drinking. And what I remember was waking up the next morning. We're as drunk as we could be, both of us sitting at the table. So that was chasing. That was how I got to, and that's the last beer I've drunk too. But I just thought, if you're doing a chasing utopia, that's what I was chasing. That book almost, you know, became, again, I keep looking for surveillance because I keep watching, but that was a lot of fun. And every now and then you get drunk, you know. it happens. I don't recommend it, of course.
Hello, my name is Andrew. What inspired you to become a writer?
I'm not good at anything else. I hate to say it like that. I'm the baby in the family, Andrew, and my sister was pretty, and my sister was smart, and my sister could play the piano, and my sister could dance. And I grew up, I don't remember it, of course, everybody reminds me, you know, when I was growing up, they said, Nikki, can you read it? No, but Gary can. Her name was Gary. No, but Gary can. Nikki, can you sing? No, but Gary can. So it was all but Gary can. And finally, as we eliminated things, all I could do was watch and write. And it kind of worked because I think that, as I think about my sister, actually, I think that there was so much pressure on her. I'm really sorry for my sister. For those of us who are younger children in this audience, you know exactly what it's like. I think that we don't realize the kind of pressure older siblings are under. And I always thought that Gary had it made. And I think to a great degree, as I look at it now, as I look back, obviously it was a lot better for me because I didn't have pressure. Nobody expected anything of me. And I could write and I could enjoy what I was doing. I used to paint a little bit. I'm not that good at painting. I'm not that bad at painting, but I guess if I had gone to paint school, I would have learned to paint somewhat. But I really liked stories and I liked reading. And I would get under the bed at night sometimes. Some of you probably do that. You get under your quilt and you have your flashlight, and I would read, and that's what I enjoyed doing. And then if you enjoy reading, then you also enjoy writing. You're looking at how do you tell this and what's happening with you and what are you paying attention to. And I'm very lucky, and I would, for any of you who are interested in writing, I would just urge you not to worry about who is accepting it. I would say write what you believe in. Just believe in yourself. Give yourself an opportunity. And remember one thing for sure, you are your first reader. And the easiest thing for writers to forget, they write things and say, I wrote this because it was funny. Did you laugh? Because if you didn't laugh, it wasn't funny. Did it scare you? Because if you're not scared, it wasn't scary. You have to realize you are your first reader. And it has to affect you. It has to mean something to you. And I don't know, I teach at Tech, and I'm very, very fortunate because we have some really good students. I'm fortunate in that for somebody like me, it has worked. But then I've let things come to me, and I think that that's kind of important too, because people keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And I, at the risk of getting on your nerves, there's just nothing better than being here in Appalachia, because there are stories to be told, there's history to be told, there's so much to be opened up. And right now, there's so little. You know, the last thing you hear about Appalachia, you know, Snuffy Smith. It's there's a new book out, Poor White Trash. And there's a story here that hasn't been told. I did the mountains because I'm, you know, Tennessean and I'm looking at that. But I'm a poet. Some of you are gonna end up writing novels, some of you are gonna end up doing something else. And the history of this area is just incredibly important to the history of America, but more to the history of the world. So that's what I keep saying to my students in Virginia Tech. Trust yourself and write the story that you want to write. Don't let these other people control what you do.
Dr. Giovanni, as I'm walking over, there are students from Pikeview High School and Bluefield High School here. And at the end of the presentation, if you guys will go up on the risers, they have asked for a photo with you.
Sure. Not a problem. I thought somebody here had her hand up.
Okay.
No, she did, I was going to say. See, I observe.
Hi, Nikki. I'm Lily. I just wanted to ask you, when or where do you find yourself most inspired to write?
When am I most inspired to write? When I'm lucky, early in the morning. Right now, every other person in the family is sick. So my aunt is in the hospital. There's only three women in the family, and Pat's husband is he's in the hospital for something else. And my friend Jenny she's not in the hospital, but she's sick. So right now, I'm not getting any time. You know, you're up at 4 o'clock in the morning making sure they're getting things. But I'm a morning person, so when I have it, when I can do what I can do, I make coffee and I can sit and the quiet. I like the quiet. And I know that you all, and again, you all are a different group. You're used to that thing, the iPhone and stuff, and you're used to information coming to you because you can what you may call it, safari it. And isn't that what it is? Yeah, something. You don't have to learn it. And I just can't encourage you enough to talk to somebody and see what their story is. And all of us are going to have different times that we do things. Some of us will be midnight writers, and you'll write from midnight to 4 in the morning, you know, whatever is comfortable. But trust learning what you're looking for. Don't just look it up and say, oh, yeah, that's not the story. That's just the information that we have. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
How you doing? My name is Charlotte Shepherd, and I have one question, and it would be, what advice do you have for a young black man in society today?
What advice do I have for a young black man?
Just coming up in society today. Just any advice that you have.
In this society today? The same advice I have for young white men, old white men, and all of the foolishness. It's the same advice. I'm just still being confused. I said it earlier. I'm confused that Donald Trump has made white men afraid. That's the one thing that, and I don't know if any of you all are writing, but it's the most fascinating question on earth. How do the people who have run the world become afraid of you? That they have to come in and shoot you? How do they get afraid? All you are is a black boy trying to get a job, trying to take care of your mama, something like that. And I think my advice to you, I don't want to give you advice because you don't need advice. What you need to do is to fall in love, do what you need to do. There are somebody, you're here at Concord. There are a lot of students here at Concord who are white who don't like you. They just don't like because they look at you and they don't like you. We know that's a fact. There are a lot of students in high school who look at black kids and they don't like them because they're black. That's all right because there's one kid who likes you. And your job is to look for the kid who likes you. Don't worry about the ones who don't, because who's going to be bothered with them? Don't worry about the ones who have something. What do you care? Find the one who does. If you come to Virginia Tech, and I hope that you all consider coming to Virginia Tech, there'll be people at Virginia Tech who won't like you, who just look at you because you're of color. They won't like you. Or because you're a woman, or because you're gay, or because whatever it is you are, they won't like you. Don't pay any, those are not the people you have to pay attention to. You have to find the people who do. If you spend all of your time worried about who doesn't like you, then you won't get anything done and you'll be unhappy. My advice to you is life is a good idea. I recommend it. It's a really good idea. And find the people that you like who like you. Learn something. Be within yourself. That's all you can do. And I think that's incredibly important. I don't think anything else falls on you. Your generation is on the other side of segregation. We were the generation, civil rights generation. Your generation is post-segregation. There's a whole new world. People like me don't know it. And so you see us standing around saying things. Every now and then, you see us on TV, not me, but other people. And they'll be saying, this is what you should do. We don't have a clue what you should do because the world that all of you are living in, white and black, is a different world from what we were growing up in. So it's up to you to find a different world. You can't let, and I keep mentioning his name because I dislike him so much, but you can't let the Donald Trumps of this world drag you back to the 50s. What we want to do is go forward. we're here in 16, we want to go into 26, we want to go into 36, we want to keep going forward, white and black. Whatever it is, we're going together. I know that. And as we go together, it's going to be a good thing that we go to. So what you want to do is, you know how to smile, so you want to smile. The people that don't smile back, to hell with them. You remember, oh, I'm not going to smile at him. And you have to remember that. And you have to go on and find what it is that makes you happy. And some of us who are white have to remember, oh, it won't kill us to smile. Hell, you're not doing anything. It won't kill you. And it'll make everybody else a little more relaxed. You don't have to have dinner. You don't have to go out with none of that. You can just smile. It's something called good morning, good afternoon. Go on about your business. And that's what's important. I think it makes all of us a little happier. You can't let other people who are using us make us afraid of each other. Just not going to happen. We have to go forward. Life is a good idea. I want to see all of you live it. I want to see all of you enjoy it. I'll be gone. I'm 73. If I'm here in 10 years, I'll be lucky. But the rest of you will be here for another 50 years or so. It should be a good life. You should be able to say, if you were born, you're going to die. We all know that. But between here and there, it ought to be something that makes you happy. It ought to be something that you can laugh about. And I recommend champagne. I know some of you drink beer, but beer's not that good. I mean, my mother drank it, but you can cook with it. I made oxtails the other night. I fixed my oxtails with the beer. But I recommend, you know, a glass of champagne every now and then. It's a good thing. Life is a good idea.
Dr. Giovanni, as I'm walking over to get your last question, because I know the high schools have to leave. Is that correct, Ms. Hyams? And you guys too? Because they have to get the buses back by a certain time. I would never try to ever quiet Nikki Giovanni. So I'm just...
It's all right. Yes, sir.
Well, you've talked about all kinds of colors. And you challenge us to be a dreamer, to find out something nobody else has found out or discovered. I want to know about those red shoes you came in here with. Your red shoes. I want to know about that.
I love red shoes. I used to teach in Oxford, England. I would go over every summer because of Texas. And in Oxford, actually, these shoes are American. But I started to fall in love with red shoes because they were Spanish. And in Oxford, they have different schools. And so one school has lavender, the red, the blue. And I needed a pair of shoes, and I went to get them. And what they had left, I would have had lavender, which would have been fabulous, but they had the red. And then I started wearing them. And then I went back like 3 years later and got another pair. And they're just about to die. So these are Johnson & Murphy. And they're red, and they're very comfortable because mine are going to go in. The chances of me going back to Oxford are slim. Actually, the chances of me, the only thing I really want to do, and I say this in all honesty, the only thing I really want to do is I really would like for Dr. Bolden, and we keep talking about this, I would really like to go to the space station. And the reason that he doesn't want to send me to the space station is that I had lung cancer, and my left lung was taken out. And so his position with me is, Nikki, I can send you up, but I can't bring you back. Because with the lung missing, my internal organs will move and it will kill me. My position to Charles is, I understand, but I'm 73. In about 5 years, how about you let me go? I'm going to die any damn way. And when I do, just open the cart. And let me out, and you all could look up and say, oh, there goes Nikki. It would be wonderful. I'm not going to live that. You know what? That's what I really want. That's what I really, really want to do. That's the last thing, because I hate to say it like that, but I've pretty much done what I was pretty much interested in doing. And space is the last frontier, I guess, in that respect. And I'm excited about the possibility. Charles is not going to let me go. I mean, I know that. He's not going to waste the time, but he's wrong. I think that he's wrong. I think that we should send, that's why I'm talking to you all, I think that we should send a writer. And that's what I keep talking to him about. He came to Tech for us. You know, I called. It was really funny. He came down to Tech, and everybody said, "How did you get Charles to come down?" I said, "I begged." I mean, what the hell you mean, how did I get him? Of course I begged, because you can't, I mean, how do you get somebody like that to come in? And he talked, all of the engineers were mad at me, because I wouldn't let him talk to the school. I brought him to talk to the writers. He just talked to the English people, and it was right there. It was so, you know, everybody's like, "How did you do that?" Because you all don't ever, you don't have anything that interests us, so why should we let you have what we, well, somebody has to remind you all. Somebody has to remind those of you who are artists, those of you who are drawing, those of you who dance, those of you, somebody has to remind you that you have to, you must find something else. This is not just about, oh, I have to get a job. There's something that's going on earth that is so fabulous. And you have to keep opening up yourself to the possibility. And so that's where I got the red shoes. I wear them all the time. The kids laugh at me, you know. But what the hell? I think I'll be buried in the red shoes. That's the truth. So thank you very, very much for being
Ladies
with me today.
Ladies and gentlemen, could you please join us, as well as Concord University's Black Student Union, Office of Multicultural Affairs and Student Support Services Program, in thanking Dr. Giovanni for coming to see us today.